Williams, and joining me, as always, is Jim Zobel. And today is the 77th anniversary of the surrender of the Japanese during World War II. And today we're going to be talking about MacArthur and what he was doing in the days leading up to the ceremony. As we all know, September 2nd, 1945, General Douglas MacArthur accepts the surrender of the Japanese in a very carefully choreographed ceremony aboard the USS Missouri in Tokyo Bay. And many people think that he landed in Japan after that ceremony and then began the occupation. But in fact, MacArthur had actually been in Japan for several days before the surrender ceremony. And today we're going to talk about what he was doing during that time and how it might have influenced his thoughts on the surrender and on Japan's future. So Jim, start us off. August 30th, 1945, several days before the surrender ceremony, MacArthur lands at Itsugi Air Base in Japan. Technically, the war is not over yet. Why does he arrive before the surrender, and whose idea is it? What is this supposed to accomplish at this point in the conflict?
It's always been that when they did the landings, the Navy commanders are in command, you know, until the army is established ashore, then the army takes over the operation. I think he looked at it in a little bit in that way, because he also doesn't want anything untoward happening. You know, they just had that uprising at the very landing strip he's going to land at Itsugi. That was a kamikaze base. And those guys had all erupted. If you look at Sakai's book about that, it's kind of interesting. So he knows that things could go uneasily. So he wants to be ashore to be able to, I guess, control those kind of things. The Navy will land at the same time that he starts landing with the 11th Airborne at Itsugi. And so I think it's kind of in that sense, but it's also that psychological thing that MacArthur will always use throughout the occupation, as far as, you know, he's there immediately and the Japanese are like, what, you know, he's already here, you know, they don't have anybody here, but yet he comes in first, you know. And I think MacArthur just looks at it in that sense, that they'll know how incredibly special that is, because he kind of does that during the war. You know, he always says it's a matter of timing. It's a matter of making the right move at the right time, even with like psychological warfare, you know, using leaflets and things like that. It's always, you know, the timing has to be perfect. And so I think he looks at it in that sense of that psychological overpowering awe. Wow, their commander is here. He's not afraid. He's not anything, but he's also wants it to go very smoothly. And, you know, he'll say to Mashbier, Mashbier is the head of like all those translators and interpreters and uses all the Nisei. And when they know they're going to go into Japan, you know, Mashbier hadn't met MacArthur since 42, like when he first started in the Southwest Pacific area. But as soon as this is going to happen, MacArthur says, no, you're part of headquarters now. And he said it was like being brought into Mount Olympus, and all of a sudden he was very connected with MacArthur. And he said that when they first got there, MacArthur, you know, looked at them all and said, well, you know, here we are, a handful of people looking down the throats of 39 well-armed Japanese divisions. You know, one false move, and it's going to make the Alamo look like a Sunday picnic. Mm. And so I think that, you know, they understand, you know, that MacArthur understands that, you know, once the emperor has said nothing's going to happen, nothing's going to happen. And so he looks at it as that army command standpoint, as well as the psychological standpoint of, you know, presenting to the Japanese.
Well, it's a very dramatic arrival. Can you walk us through it?
Yeah, well, Colonel Charles Tench, he had gone in on the 28th. And he had gone in with about 150 11th Airborne Pathfinders. These are a lot of engineers that'll go in and start working on the Itsugi field, and they'll get that all ready for the amount of airplanes that are going to come in, because MacArthur is planning on flying in the entire 11th Airborne to Atsugi. When his airborne engineer, Leif Sverdrup, met with Truman, right before Truman picked MacArthur to be the Supreme Commander, Truman was like, well, how's he going to get there? You know, how's he going to get there and establish power? And Sverdrup was like, he's going to fly right in, you know, just like he's always done, you know, with General Kinney, you know, from the early days. And so the 28th, the Colonel's Tench goes in, and then on the 29th, MacArthur and the rest of the party, they fly to Okinawa. And that morning on the 30th, they're going to fly into Tokyo. Weldon Dusty Rhodes is the pilot. He's, you know, supposed to be taking over Eastern Airlines, but MacArthur asked for an extension, you know, let him stay here because he was MacArthur's pilot. And Rhodes goes to the C-54 baton that morning, and he's so drenched in sweat because it's the tropics, you know, of Okinawa, and the humidity's so bad, that he's standing under the plane changing his pants right when MacArthur rolls up. And so it's this big comedy show, and MacArthur's just ribbing Rhodes so bad. And, you know, that night when they all get to the Yokohama Grand Hotel and they're all eating dinner there, MacArthur goes into this story about Rhodes being caught with his pants down, and, you know, embellishes it only the way that MacArthur can embellish it. So that starts it off, you know, for them going to Japan. And it's very good natured. Rhodes, everybody said they never saw MacArthur happier than when they go to Japan. And he said, you know, everybody was nervous on the plane. It's a three-plane move in. Kenny and those guys are on one plane. There's some other guys on another plane, but it's three C-54s. And Whitney said they took off from Atsugi and there was no fighter coverage. And he was like, what's going on? But as soon as they saw Mount Fuji, all of a sudden there was this umbrella of fighters that was all over them going in. Now, Joseph Swing and the 11th Airborne, he's the major general that runs them. They had been stationed on Okinawa because they were getting ready for the invasion of Japan. And they fly in at about 6 that morning and get operations going. The signal communications guy set up communications with Manila, as well as the USS Teton, which is out in Tokyo Bay now, because they've now moved into the bay. The Marines and the Blue Jackets of the Navy have started landing at Yokosuka. And by that night, they'll have 4,000 airborne on the ground. MacArthur's plane flies in at about 2 o'clock, and they, you know, they, Rhodes says they landed 2, Mashbeer says they landed 2:14, the Navy says, you know, and other these people say they landed 2:18, but whatever, they land right about that time, a Jeep pulls them off the runway, and MacArthur gets out, and there's Swing, there's Eichelberger waiting, you know, Eichelberger's the 8th Army commander, he'll be running most of the occupation forces. And they're waiting for MacArthur, and MacArthur comes down and basically says to Eichelberger, this is the payoff, you know, and I think it's the sense of it's all over. And, you know, now we just get to kind of enjoy it and not be so tense or worried, you know, all the time. You know, they have this occupation they're embarking on, but it's, you know, MacArthur's like, let's enjoy this while we can. And so they get on they gather together all these vehicles. Now, when Tench had arrived on the 28th, he went to Yokohama and he secured the Grand Hotel for MacArthur's party. And it's about 15 miles. And they get on in these cars. It's a whole assortment of cars. A lot of them are running on charcoal, you know, because the Japanese don't have anything. You know, at least that's the suspect. And it's kind of like this carnival of jalopies that are going to Yokohama. They say in the countryside where they go, and they take the back road because they don't want to take the main road where Japanese will all be in congregation. But they say through the countryside, you don't notice anything. But once you get to Yokohama, it's totally devastated and everything's destroyed. The only thing that isn't is the hotel and the customs house and the prefectural building, which they'll use as headquarters. And so MacArthur gets set up there in the hotel that day of the 30th. They get there about 4:30.
Are there Japanese troops in the vicinity that are armed?
Well, yeah. I mean, they got there kind of early. Nobody was supposed to go into Tokyo. And there's a few Japanese at the airport. When Tench arrived, General Arisawa was there. He's the head of Japanese intelligence. You know, he's the guy that's there. Like, are these Americans going to play it straight, or are we going to go guerrilla? And he's there as well when Swing and Eichelberger land. There's no pictures that I see or anybody saying that MacArthur sees this guy when he gets there. But there's some Japanese newsmen there. There's a lot of correspondence there already, and the 11th Airborne guys when MacArthur lands. Now, on the way to Yokohama, there are the Japanese that are by the road, and they are armed, and as their cars approach, they turn their back like the way they would to the emperor. And so a lot of people are saying, you know, that's disrespect, but, MacArthur understood exactly what they're doing. Now, when they get to the hotel on the 30th, MacArthur tells Mashbeer, go to Tokyo right now and, you know, see what it's like at the embassy, because MacArthur's planning on going there. So Mashbeer goes out, and all of a sudden, Roger Eggeberg, MacArthur's other aide, Leif Sverdrup, that engineer, Casey, MacArthur's main engineer, and I can't remember who the other one, but they all get in the cars and go to Tokyo. And when they get to Shinagawa Station, there's a whole Japanese armed division, you know, right there in the streets, blocking the road. And the private driver looks at Mashbeer and says, well, what do you want me to do now? And Mashbeer's like, just lay on the horn. They're going to have to get used to it sooner or later. And they do. They start just blasting their way through. And the Japanese, and they say that's about all of them. They don't look at them with any hostility or even any curiosity. They're just like deadpan, you know, to them. And they get to the embassy fine. So, I mean, yeah, there's armed Japanese everywhere, but, you know, they've been told what to do. And they've already had their uprisings, like on the 15th and the 17th, when they tried to, you know, go to the palace and overthrow, you know, having that recording played, and when they made the attacks on the, you know, the ministers of state, you know, right before then. So the Japanese aren't going to do anything. Mashbeer gets that back that night and says, you know, we can go in there and start working on this. So yeah, Japanese are everywhere, you know.
So it's still a potentially volatile situation. And I think I've read that Winston Churchill says that it's one of the bravest acts of the war when MacArthur kind of goes in early with all those guys. Have you read that?
Yeah. And, you know, you got to think about it, you know, that landing, you know, like MacArthur said, it would make the Alamo look, you know, incredible. And only, you know, a week before at Sugi, those kamikazes had uprisen, you know, and they know what it's like. You know, Whitney talks about it a lot in his letters that he writes while on the plane going to Japan, that we know things could happen, but we'll just take that in our stride as we always have. You know, these guys have been through 4 years. Those airborne guys, you know, are there. You know, they won't, you know, if they try to go at them with 39 divisions, you know, I doubt they would, you know, have any chance. But there's one story. Colonel Burgess, he's a commander in the 11th Airborne, and he went to meet with some of the Japanese generals and whatnot that were working on pulling the troops out of Tokyo and sending them home and back to their own districts. And, you know, these were all lieutenant generals and colonels and brigadier generals, and Burgess is like a major. And when they finish the meeting, Burgess goes to leave the room first. And this Japanese colonel gets up and starts, you know, holding his arms, you know, trying to say, you know, you stay here. And Burgess grabs him by the throat and puts a knife to his throat, you know, right there, because he doesn't know what's going on. And, you know, they're like, and he, the interpreter comes over and says, you know, no, the generals leave first. The high-ranking people leave the room first, not a major. And Burgess is like, look, I'm the highest-ranking person giving orders in this room right now. You know, I mean, he just like went back to instinct. So it shows, you know, that they're still on this protocol thing, but, you know, they don't intend to harm anyone. You know, so, I mean, all these people are ready for it, but, you know, nothing materializes. And you know, so they see that it's going to go, you know, pretty smoothly.
So, I mean, MacArthur clearly judged the situation right. But I guess I always wonder what would have happened, say, if he had been assassinated before the war ends. Does the war end on September 2nd, 1945?
Yeah, I know.
Does more happen?
What, do they pull out and here comes more atomic bombs? No, I don't, you know, that's what if, who knows, man.
Do we know what the Japanese thought of his arrival?
Well, Rhodes, and that's the pilot, says to MacArthur, you know, General, I don't think they want you here, you know, at the hotel, you know, because it was kind of a burden, you know, to them, because they didn't have any food, they didn't have toilet paper, they didn't have anything, you know. And MacArthur looks at him and says, well, I'm not exactly here by invitation, you know. And so he can understand that the Japanese, you know, are not looking forward to this, you know, who would be, but he wants it to go smoothly. He's like, don't cause any trouble. He immediately sees that they're starving. You know, there's only fish at the hotel, and Japan had stopped fishing because they were just getting creamed out in the harbors. And so all the food that they have is something that had been stored away. And they said it was basically just rancid fish, you know, but MacArthur was like, you eat all of it, show them that, you know, it doesn't bother us. But then he puts out an order, I think on that second day, that's like, you won't be taking food from the Japanese. You won't be, you know, trying to buy food off them. You know, they are starving right now, and we're not going to add to that burden, you know? And so, I mean, he lays down the law pretty quick. I think he sees, you know, what's going on there, and he's definitely not going to do anything, or doesn't want anybody exacerbating the situation.
Mm-hmm. So what is he doing in those days in Japan leading up to the actual surrender ceremony?
Well, you know, we talked about that first day. The second day, on the 31st, they set up the headquarters at the customs house. They set up the liaison office at the prefectural office. And that's where, like, R.J. Marshall Sutherland will set up. They'll start meeting with all the Japanese, ironing out the last pieces of the puzzle, you know, with them, working them, getting them to the setup. Mashbear comes to see him that morning, and MacArthur orders him to get the Japanese working on the embassy. He tells Mashbear to set up a mess for all the officers. MacArthur doesn't want to have a private mess. He wants, like, a, you know, to get the banquet room set up so they can serve 50 officers, all the dignitaries that are going to be there at all the time. So MacArthur's having little meetings with, you know, everybody, you know, that's coming around. He's seeing Rhodes. Rhodes finds out that Whipple, who's the guy who's running the surrender for MacArthur, all the like Wainwright, Percival, the Russian, and, you know, guy Derevyanko, they're all showing up at Itsugi, and they need people down there to get them all in. So MacArthur's telling, you know, Rhodes to go down there, help. So he's like guiding certain little things on the 31st. He's also working on his speech. He's going to have to give two of them on the Missouri. That's what he's going to be working on, you know, a great deal for it. Then that night, you know, when Rhodes goes down, Wainwright, Percival come in, and there's no transport to get him because some other goofball general showed up and said, you know, you're some colonel, not going to order me around. So he takes the cars that are meant for, like, General Kruger and, you know, all these other people. And then Kruger shows up and he's totally ticked off and finds a car, but doesn't give Wainwright or Percival a ride, you know, into Yokohama. He just goes himself and, you know, Rhodes and all these other people are like, you know, what a jerk, man. You don't even help us out. And he said the best one out of them all was the Russian, because they get on this bus and the bus breaks down and they have to transfer to the other bus. And Derevyanko, this Russian, is carrying everybody's luggage. He's got a couple of bottles of vodka. He breaks them out. Everybody's, you know, sipping off these bottles, having a great time, you know, while trying to make it through. And then they get to the Grand Hotel and everybody's at dinner. And that's when they announce Wainwright's there. And, you know, it's that reunion of Wainwright and MacArthur, you know. And Wainwright had had to surrender on Corregidor, felt like he had, you know, betrayed, was going to be court-martialed, everything. And he shows up and you know, MacArthur hadn't shown much grace after his surrender, but immediately he's immediately choked up and crying. And you know, people defer on whether he just sat there saying skinny, skinny over and over again, which was, you know, his nickname for Wainwright before the war, or whether he was going Jim, Jim. But everybody there said it was pretty out of control. And Wainwright was just like, I just want a corps in your command. And MacArthur was like, you know, you can have anything you want. Of course, Wainwright was very sick, never, you know, see anything like that again. But it was totally, you know, everybody had built up how much animosity there was between the two. And there really wasn't, you know, at that point, once they saw each other, whatever had been in their thoughts went out the door, you know, out the window. And so they're all there. Nimitz comes to see MacArthur. He takes a destroyer and comes to see MacArthur at the hotel to talk about some things. Nimitz had flown in on the 29th as the Third Fleet entered Tokyo Bay. He had flown in on a seaplane and set up a shop there on the South Dakota. And so he comes to see MacArthur, but that day also the Japanese told MacArthur that all these homes that were owned by Standard Oil in Yokohama had pretty much been unbombed. And so MacArthur goes to see those, or Fellers had gone there, you know, another military secretary had gone to see the house and said it would look really nice. So MacArthur goes over there with Mashbeer and everybody else and is like, okay, we'll move into here, you know, after the ceremony, we'll move into here to get everything ready. And then they go back to the hotel. And that night we know that MacArthur goes to see Courtney Whitney, you know, his other aide, and says, you know, I want to use 6 pens in the surrender ceremony and I've got 5. And I wonder if you'll let me use, you know, your pen. And so MacArthur pretty much, you know, he's meeting with people, he's working things out, but he's letting Sutherland and Marshall do all the meetings with the Japanese. He's letting Mashbeer do all that. He's just, you know, kind of instructing them as what, you know, he wants and things like that. But mostly I think he's working on those two speeches, you know, throughout those days. Mm-hmm.
So by the time he's in Japan, most of the occupation goals have already been sketched out. But does being in Japan early alter any of his thinking about the surrender and Japan's future, or does it confirm what he already believes about Japan and what needs to be done?
I think it's what you just said. You know, it confirms what he believes. You know, when he comes there and sees them ready to work with them, when he comes there and sees that they're all starving to death, mm-hmm. I think that it can, you know, and plus when he was on Okinawa, he had received from the State War Naval Coordinating Committee, you know, from the Joint Chiefs of Staff as well, the outline for what they expected of him. Mm-hmm. And it kind of, you know, from seeing how he had talked with other aides and whatnot before he goes into Japan, it seems that, you know, he had pretty much seen what they were going to say, you know, and his ideas were right along in, you know, with the democratization and the demilitarization of Japan. And I think it just confirms it, because he sees that the Japanese are going to be willing to go along with it, you know. You know, like Mashbeer said, you know, when Mashbeer comes up there, you know, he had worked seriously in Japan before the war, and he knew the Japanese pretty well. You know, he knows all those people that are on the Missouri. He had known them before the war. That delegation that came down to Manila, he knew two of those guys. And he said, you know, the Japanese are going to treat this like a judo match. You know, that you fight to really destroy your opponent. But once it's over, it's like, get up, slap back, happy, you know, let's work together, you know, and he was kind of worried about that because he didn't want to be drawn right back into, you know, oh yeah, we're all buddy, buddy, you know, after everything that had happened. But MacArthur, I think, sees it in the sense of, you know, okay, yeah, as long as the emperor's going to work with it, these people are down at their last gasp. You know, they have nowhere to go. You know, they totally have lost faith in their leaders. So, you know, I think that this will work. Mm-hmm.
So we've talked about the surrender ceremony before. So why don't you take us maybe up to the moment of the actual surrender? MacArthur has a big job ahead of him, but after years of pressure and strain, you know, the morning of the ceremony must have brought a lot of relief, you know, for him, for Nimitz, for, you know, the other officers there at the ceremony. So tell us about that morning from, say, MacArthur's departure, heading towards the Missouri, to what it was like behind the scenes before he steps out onto the deck for the ceremony.
Marshall and Mashby are up at about 5, and they're down at the docks of Yokohama, which is kind of right near the hotel, at about 6. And the reporters are all just taken off. They're leaving for the Missouri to get, you know, positioned where they're going to be. And then Mashbier's there to meet the Japanese delegation, which shows up right at about 6:55. And 3 destroyers are going to carry out everybody. The Lansdowne will take the Japanese. And so they get on at about, they get on and that leaves promptly at 7. And then the Nicholas comes up and all the dignitaries, like all the Army officers, all the Air Force officers, all the foreign officers that have flown in, all the people that are going to sign, you know, they'll get on that at 7:15 and they take that out. At about 7:30, MacArthur shows up at the docks and the Buchanan will take them. Now the Navy had in Guam, they had built this launch for MacArthur and it was like, you know, red and blue and was kind of small. And MacArthur, they had shown it to MacArthur on the first because they had like, you know, specially transported it up to Guam. And this was going to be the special boat that took MacArthur out to the ship. But on the first, when they showed it to him, Whitney said it was almost like a typhoon out because it was raining so hard. And MacArthur goes and sees this thing, and the seas in Manila Bay are like huge. This thing's being tossed around like a, you know, a bobber. And MacArthur's like, there is no way I'm taking that out to the Missouri. You know, I want a destroyer, I want a new one. Get me out of there. At least that's what Hal LaBar said, who was Nimitz's, you know, guy. And so it turns out that they'll take the USS Buchanan. MacArthur gets there. Wainwright and Percival had missed the dignitary boat, so they'll get on the boat with MacArthur, Buchanan, the ship that's taking them out to the Missouri. They all eat breakfast on the Buchanan. MacArthur is buoyant, but a little off. And, you know, Rhodes is like, what's going on? You know, he doesn't seem, you know, what the way he was on the plane, you know, all excited and everything. He's more businesslike. And the Nicholas gets to the Missouri first, and they unload on to the Missouri, all the dignitaries. And then at about 8:30, the Buchanan comes in, and they'll get aboard the Missouri as well. And MacArthur will go on and he'll meet McCarney, you know, who he'd known for since Southwest Pacific days. Halsey's there, you know, his best friend from the war. And Nimitz are all there to meet them as they come aboard. And Halsey takes them back into his captain's cabin. See, it's going to be under the ceremony, like we said before, will be under the number two turret. So that's on the starboard side of the ship. And so they take him to the captain's cabin, which is like right behind that. And they've talked about how Halsey offered him coffee and MacArthur was like, no, I really don't want to have any more. You know, I had plenty on the ship. And Rhodes is called in to see MacArthur. And he goes in there and MacArthur's thrown up in the sink, you know, retching pretty heavily. And that's MacArthur's thing. You know, when he'd get into these situations, you know, it would get to him, you know, that he's going to be, you know, like when he tells Roosevelt at the White House, you know, that the next bullet, next last breath out of that next boy's mouth is going to be Roosevelt, not MacArthur, you know, and then Roosevelt called him out and he barfs all over the place. Or when he's with the 503rd Airborne, right, before they go into NADZAB, and he's going to fly with them, and, you know, before he, you know, does it, he throws up, you know, and it's not so much, you know, being scared or anything, it just, you know, the magnitude of things that he does gets to him. And so Rhodes is like, man, he's, you know, there's like a couple of minutes to go here. And the Japanese show up on board at 8:55. And then Horace Byrd, who's the commander on the Missouri, he's the gunnery officer. He's like, you know, officers, can you please take your positions? You know, and nobody moves. Everybody's yammering. Nobody's listening to him. And all of a sudden he's just, you know, attention all hands. And everybody shuts up. You know, everybody goes into place. And the Japanese, you know, are brought on deck. Mashbeer had ridden out on the Lansdowne with them. And, you know, they had asked him, you know, are we supposed to smile? You know, are we supposed to, you know, look like, you know, we're enjoying this? And Mashbeer was like, no, just look like you're not caring. Meaning, you know, just have a deadpan look, you know, just go on and get it over with. And so they're on there and then they have the chaplain does this invocation, the Star Spangled Banner is played, and then MacArthur, Halsey, Nimitz, and Halsey walk out of the wardroom one after the other, and MacArthur goes right up to the microphone, and Rhodes is like, he looked like he was totally in control, like you would have never thought that a minute and a half ago he was, you know, puking up his breakfast, you know, and then he goes on to give probably the greatest speech of his career.
Mm-hmm. All right. Well, any final thoughts about MacArthur and those early days in Japan?
I have thoughts about the surrender on the Missouri.
Sure.
Well, 10 years ago, I got to give, you know, a speech on Missouri on this day. Mm-hmm. And today I'm stuck with you, Williams.
Yeah. Well, I'm sorry about that, but thanks for sharing your expertise as always.